Hi again, it's Pat, sales engineer, and I realized, my little helpers are everywhere, I realized that the last time I did a video on writing with a fountain pen, one of the things I didn't do was explain how to write with a fountain pen. Yes, I know that sounds funny, but I talk so much about the parts of it and holding it and everything. I never really got around to explaining how to actually write with it. So, one of the things I want to do for you here is I want to go ahead and talk about exactly that. I have with me some ink that should be really interesting for you to use. Brown from Monteverde. And I've got my new favoriteest pen ever, the Joseph Gillett stainless steel pen, the 1160. This guy, which is my absolute favoriteest pen ever this week. So, I'm going to take a little bit of paper towels. My helpers are running around like crazy. So let's hope they stay out of our hair. And I want to get right to it. So let me make sure, yep, we can pretty much see everything with the camera here. Using two angles, because it's going to be a little easier to see. I don't know about how I'm going to mix the two videos together, but we'll see. It always works out. Now, one of the things that there's actually three or four different things, if you don't count the ink itself. There's a few things to consider, and let's talk about each of them. And we're talking about just in order to write. So, first of them, the first is going to be posture. The second is going to be hand slash arm, wrists, you know, all that. The next thing to consider is going to be the paper or whatever medium it might be. In most cases it'll be paper, but there's so many different variations to paper, aren't there? And the fourth is going to be the actual pen itself, which is comprised of the nib and the holder. And I'm just going to say holder because, yeah, you can use, we can be talking about regular, you know, internal ink pens, or we can talk about pens like I'm using right here. Either way, it's the holder that we're talking about. And finally, the fifth thing, because we're not talking about the ink itself, the fifth thing is going to be what you're doing. So, what are you doing? Are you writing, like I am? Are you printing, like I'm not? Are you drawing? Are you even signing, right? Which is a different kind of stylish writing. Or is it something else? So these are the things that go into play. And maybe knowing about all of them will help, maybe not. So, I'm going to talk about each one briefly because the videos are quite popular, and as a result of that, I've gone and started up a site where these videos are posted and more detail on them, and that's called The Pen Pro. That's the domain. So you put your HTTP, The Pen Pro. And actually it refers to all of you as professionals, not as me. So, what do you think of this brown? It's nice and dark, isn't it? It's very interesting. I reviewed this earlier when we talked about my haul from ISell Pens with Todd. So let's talk about posture. You can't see me, but and let's face it, you can't always pick where you're going to be when you're writing. For people who are able to, they find that just like when you're typing, your posture being in a natural position. Now remember, these tables these days, most of them are 30 inches off the ground. And that's just regular seating. There is 33, which is considered, I think, high dining, and then 36, which is more like bar tops. But most of the time, we're sitting, you know, at a 30-inch table like I am right here. And your feet are flat and whatnot. I'm leaning forward as I talk to you, partly because I don't want to be in the video, but also because it's comfortable for me in this position where my chair is here. It's comfortable for me because I have my arms leaning against the table itself, which makes it so that my weight is pressed onto the table. Now, my posture is such, and I think the only thing I really want to tell you about posture is your posture should be such that you're able to be in that position for quite a long time. So, like right now, I don't have to get up and stretch or anything. It feels fine just the way my back is now. So time should be something that, you know, is going to work in your favor. And for me, it does. So that's what I want you to do. Just be conscious of the fact, number one here, is of your posture. Because if you're sitting in a chair that doesn't give you support, or I'm leaning, you know, I don't have any support here, then you're just going to become uncomfortable no matter what you do. It doesn't matter if you're writing or not. So, let me see if I can get this camera to be a little more, a more productive angle. There we go. A little bit better. Okay. The next is going to be, oh, you can't see it on camera. There it is. Hand, arm, and wrist. Now, most people, if you're like me, well, see, now I moved the camera and I really shouldn't have. Most people, if you're like me, you want to have your wrist such that it's elevated off the table. My wrist sits on this book. Now, mind you, this is a relatively thick book of 60-pound paper, right? The base of my palm, this part right here that's it's hitting the bottom of the book, this is the business end of all of my motion, range, and steadying. So as I'm writing, and again I'm trying to get this little thing to sit in a decent angle, maybe that's it, I don't know, I'm sure I'll get comments. So as we're sitting here, and I've got my hand such that it's resting on this little guy, I'm able to have a wide variety or range of motion. And so for number two, I like to have, I rest my wrist. So it's not even my wrist, it's the palm. I think that's the best way to explain it. So I make sure that I rest the palm on the actual... Oh, where are we at? Here we go. Oop. What is he doing with that damn camera? Okay. So hopefully I'm just trying to find an angle here that works for you. So here I am with my palm down, and I'll just take another sheet here, turning this over, and I have my hand resting here, and I might let my pinky give me that balance. And so if I need to have my pen in one specific location, I'll put my pinky down here and it gives me that kind of stable platform. Whereas if I'd have just lifted up, it might look as though it's much more fluid, but it's actually very difficult to draw very small things. And I found with dry boards and everything else that the closer you are to the point that the fluid comes out onto the medium supported, the better stable you are. So if I'm holding my hand up in the air like this and there's nothing touching the table, I find it very hard to draw these squares very accurately. My hand shaking, my elbow shaking, my whole body, any part of my body can make this change. However, if I have fingers resting and I'm all the way down up close, and even this little finger, the one right next to these two guys, is resting on the actual paper like it is here, then when I write, I can do very, very, very fine lines very, very consistently. And that's what you want to bear in mind. How close can you be to what you're doing and provide that stability? Now, if you're doing a flowing signature, flowing, your hand is going to be moving and sliding across. You're drawing wavy, wavy lines like in calligraphy. And yes, you're still going to find yourself, though, resting your hand down. So, posture. Okay, that's my little helpers are running around right now. That's the noise you're hearing. Your hand, arm, and wrist are kind of all part of posture. The paper and the medium that you're using. This is number three. Different papers will take ink differently. And just like not all inks are the same, not all papers are going to be the same. And the way you write when you have, let's say, I hope I still have it here, a little piece of graph paper that was, or let's just take this, just take some regular copier paper. This is just, I don't know what this is, just regular cheap copier paper. When I'm writing on this, and I find myself finding it very slippery, and I'm able to make nice flowing lines on this because the paper pulp on this is very, very fine, right? It's like white bread. When I write on a heavy paper, like a 60-pound paper like this is your wheat bread, your whole nut. Now, because I find a lot of texture to this paper, a lot of people really like that. But, and the good thing is, of course, it's not going to bleed through with damn near any ink. And I find that I write slower on rough paper. And I don't know why, but I think it's because I have much more of a tactile feel. I get more out of the paper. And perhaps that's why, I don't know. The slippery or slidey paper, the cheap paper, I'm not really as careful with it. It feels temporary. It feels very cheap. And so my writing is very cheap. I don't bother to make my letters look very nice. It's not for posterity. It's just going to get balled up and thrown in the trash, right? So, let's take a look at the nib itself and the pen holder. There are all kinds of different sizes, from this little tiny guy to, I got a real fat one here by comparison, and different shapes. And each of these shapes for your pen is going to make you grip it differently. And I gotta tell you, if you've never really looked at how you write before, notice sometime, especially if you write with pencils and pens, notice sometimes how hard you press on the paper. When you're writing a quick note, you might write it, you know, very, very stiffly on the paper. And you're pushing down and you're making an impression. And if you're writing something, let's say it's very thoughtful, you might write it much more differently. You might take your time going through the letters. And you might actually care how elegant they look or even how legible. Mine are neither. They are not legible. I'm the mad scientist. So, just be mindful of the pressure that you put on something. Something I found is when I'm concentrating on something and I'm trying to do something very small, some very, very small details, I notice that I'm very close to the work and I'm really paying a lot of attention to it, and I find that my hand starts to hurt. And when your hand is hurting, it's a sign that, yes, you're pushing down too hard, but you're also grasping the instrument in such a way that you're exerting way too much pressure, just holding it. Not pressing down, but just holding it. And if you do that, and you find yourself doing it, again, if you've probably never thought of this before when you write, or you get half a page done of writing a letter, and you're like, wow, I really got to relax my hand. Try this. Try taking your favorite pen and putting it into a completely different sized holder. Try something super thin. The delicate feel of something smaller than a French fry might make you not want to press down as much and not want to clasp it for its last breath. And likewise, a big nib holder, a nice fat one, will give you the feel of something that doesn't quite take as much pressure to achieve the result. And a bigger object is actually harder to grasp tightly than it is a very tiny one. So if you're in the middle here and you're feeling like, oh, you know, I just have this cramp, this horrible style, and, you know, I really do talk to people that say, you know, I don't like the way I write, I don't like writing by hand, and, you know, you ask them why and they can't quite put their finger on it. They're like, well, I don't know, it just never worked out. People who are allergic to shellfish have a diet that does not include shellfish. Things just work out. So be mindful of this and take a look at how you're writing and how you write in different circumstances. And that leads us directly to what you're writing. And early on, we had said that there were a couple. There was, trying to move a couple things out of the way here. Got too many things to move out of the way. All right, I'll just move this. You have different kinds of pens will do different things. And that was our helper. This pen has a reservoir on it compared to the one that doesn't. Can you see it? It's a clip-on. And I'll try to make it so you can see them. Try to make the focus. There we go. You can see how this guy has a clip and it lets it hold more ink. And the reason is because it's nicer not to have to go back and dip any more times than you have to, because it disrupts the line of thought that you had and whatnot. Now, I don't look for that as much. I look for the quality of the pen itself. This one, of course, being, like I told you, the Joseph Gillett pen that is my absolute all-time favorite this week. And I really like this guy. In fact, it's going to take a lot for me to move this guy off of the favorite pile. because it's the best of both worlds. It's letting me draw and it's letting me write. And it excels at both. Such an amazing thing, isn't it? A little tiny piece of metal can be shaped in so many different ways. It's just a little piece of metal. But what you're writing, what you're doing, and everything, I want to end up with saying that what you're writing, whether it's a letter or whether you're just printing something out that's perhaps instructions and it has to be legible, maybe you're drawing and you're just drawing shapes and doodling, maybe even signing something, a big important letter. The pen that you have is absolutely crucial to how satisfied you're going to be. And satisfaction is the name of the game, isn't it? We want to know, for a given amount of effort, are we getting back enough for our effort? And you want happiness and joy with your pens, just like you want in your toilet paper and your eggs and your milk and everything else. So we all want to be happy consumers. And the way that we get to be happy is we start understanding things about what we're using. So in the case of pens, we need to understand pens better in order to be happy mad scientists, right? So what I ask is, before you decide that you don't want something, before you decide that you hate something, before you say, oh, that's not for me, you give it a chance, because these little guys, these pens, vary so much that I have in my collection pens that if you picked them up and you wrote with them, you would never pick up another pen. You would say, this is absolutely awful, I can't do anything with it, it's just not for me. And I don't think that's fair. I don't think it's fair to the hobby or the activity of using these pens. I think you owe it to yourself to be as happy as you can in life, and that might require that you go to the dressing room a few times and you actually check stuff out. You might need to actually try a few things on. God forbid, right? So, what I suggest is you give inks and pens lots of choices, try lots of them out. Now you can see it's brown now compared to the black. This is black quink that's here. You can see the difference in the brown. Give them a try, because it said that I get ink all over me. It said that the best expression that you can possibly have in this life is the written word. So much goes into the personalization of the written word, where it doesn't happen with the computer. So handwriting, maybe it's going to go away, maybe not. Maybe everybody's going to have a tablet and they're going to write that way. I don't know if they're even teaching proper writing in schools today. But this is the most personal thing you can do, is to write by hand. Get the best instrument you possibly can. This pen cost about 15 cents. And I love it more than some I have here for $5. The pen holder, about $1. You could probably make one just as easy. The inks, well, this is a 3-ounce bottle, and this will probably last me years and years, especially considering I have more than just this kind and color of ink. So what you write is far more expensive, far more valuable than what you're writing it with. So enjoy the art of writing with a fine instrument. And if you have to, rediscover the art of writing. Rediscover why it is so good and why it is so important that we get fountain pens and old-style nib pens like this, dip pens, into the hands of kids when they're young. And let them see that there was such a thing back in the day as actual handwriting. Okay? My God, that child looks scared to death. So, with that, I leave it to you. The best thing you can do for the art of fine penmanship is to hand a pen to somebody else. All right? So see if you can't do that. Take a pen that you love, bring it with you, find somebody, throw it in their hand and say, what do you think of this? All right? That's my challenge to you. And that's it from the sales engineer. Don't forget, I've just started it up. The Pen Pro, the pen.pro, mostly a discussion system, but also a blog. And I'm going to be putting these videos up there that I've done on YouTube up there as well. And a lot more discussion about each one. And that's it from the sales engineer. Sorry if that was a bit lengthy for you, or a little too esoteric and wordy, but I love you guys, so that's why I care. Till next time.